Another little baby girl.
Oh, I can't wait to see her, Mama.
Well, put on the proper dress. Take a hat.
Mama, don't be mad. Please don't be, but I'm an aunt for the second time now, and I still don't know how it happens. I'm ashamed to even ask, but then who can I ask but you?
Well, that child, you cannot imagine that.
But you can't imagine that I still believe in the stork.
I honestly don't know what I've done to deserve this kind of talk.
And on a day like today.
Come, child, put your clothes on.
And what if I'd run out now? And ask Gregor? The milkman?
Very well, I'll tell you everything. But not today. Tomorrow. Or the day after.
Oh, come today, Mama!
When thought Buck and I simply can't.
Mama!
You'll drive me mad!
But why? I'll kneel at your feet, and I'll lay my head on your lap. You can talk as if I weren't even here.
Very well. I'll tell you. Child, I...
Please, Mama?
For a woman to bear a child, you follow me?
Yes, Mama.
In order for a woman to conceive a child, she must, in her own personal way, she must love her husband like she can love only him. Only Him. She must love with her whole
heart. There, now you know everything.
Everything?
Everything, sure.
Mama!
Arma virum quae cano, Troiae qui primus ab oris Italium, fato profugus, Laviniaque venit litora...
Mr. Stiefel! Mr. Stiefel!
Yes, ma'am?
Continue, please!
Laviniaque venit...
Yes?
Litora multum... Enim?
Enim.
Multum olim?
Multum olim. So then somehow, Pius Aeneas has already suffered much in the days still to come. Mr. Stiefel, do you have any idea what you're saying, Mr. Stiefel?
If you please.
Pardon me.
No, he always has to be the hero.
Silence! Mr. Gabor.
If you please, Miss Lawrence, can we at least consider multum olim as a plausible conjecture for how the text might read?
Mr. Gabor, we are hardly here today to conjecture about textual conjecture. The boy has made an error.
Yes, but an understandable error, ma'am. If you could only entertain the fitness of the conjecture...
Multum olim.
Look to the fresh rhetorical balance. Multum olim introducing multa coque. A parallel between what Aeneas has already suffered in war and those sufferings on land and sea just ahead.
Mr. Gabor, since the days of Servius, Aulus Gellius, and Claudius Donatus, nay, since the moment of Ferjar's death, our world has been littered with more than sufficient critical commentary on textual conjecture.
With all respect, ma'am. Are you then suggesting there's no further room for critical thought or interpretation? Why indeed then do-
I am suggesting no such thing. I am confirming that Mr. Stiefel has made an error. And I am asking, nay, demanding that you emend his faulty text and proceed from there. Do I make myself clear? Mr. Gabor, do I make myself clear?
Yes, Miss Lawrence. Victoria Motum Ila.
All of you, together with Melchior Gabor. Laviniaque venit.
Litora multum ile. Et teris, jactatus et alto. Vi supero.
Somehow.
In breque Deus Latium, the following 7 lines of pious Aeneas Gen. From memory.
Melky, thank you. It's nothing.
You saved your ass, Moritz.
But still, you shouldn't have.
Well, think what Aeneas has suffered.
I should have known. Multum ille. It's just, I didn't sleep at all last night. In fact, I suffered a visit from a most dark, horrific fantasy.
You mean a dream?
A nightmare, really. Legs in sky blue stockings, climbing over the lecture podium.
Oh, that kind of dream.
Have you ever suffered such mortifying visions?
Moritz, of course, we all have.
Thomas dreamt about his mother.
Really?
And Oliver dreamt he was seduced by his piano teacher.
Hey, shut up,
Taylor.
Much deeper. And he hardly reminds you that of all our pupils, you are in no position to be taking liberty. I will not warn you again.
Gotta go. Mrs. Taylor will not be kept waiting, if you know what I mean.
See you later.
Ah, Melky. 60 lines of Homer. All those quadratic equations. I'll be up all night again, haunted by another one of those dreams. And still I won't get through it.
Ah, yes. Your dreams.
Melky, why am I haunted by the legs of a woman? By the deepening conviction that some dark part of my fantasy may lie there between them.
All right, I'll tell you.
I got enough books. But prepare yourself and made an atheist of me. So let's...
No. Not here. Look. Write it down. All of it. And then conceal it in my satchel after gymnastics tomorrow, all right? If you'd like, you could add some illustrations in the margins.
Top to bottom?
Everything.
Principal Figgins. Unfathomable. Melchior Gabor. A young man of distinct intellectual capability. Thoroughly distinct. A young man who could be my finest pupil. My finest. But there he is. Polluting himself. Cavorting about with that neurasthenic imbecile, Moritz Stiefel.
Thank heavens you'll never pass the final exam.
They're decking the entire sanctuary in orchids and chrysanthemums.
Mama said no.
Well, I certainly hope your mama's gonna approve the one I marry.
And the one I marry?
Well, I know who I would like to marry.
Who?
Melchior Gabor.
No! That sad, soulful sleepyhead.
Moritz Stiefel.
Moritz Stiefel?
Well, he is rather handsome.
How can you even compare the two? Melchior Gabor, oh, he's such a radical. You know what the rumor is? He doesn't believe in anything. Not in God, not in heaven, not in a single thing in this world.
They say he's the best in everything. Latin, Greek, trigonometry.
And the best part is, he doesn't care a whit about any of it.
Thank you.
October 16th. The question is, shame. What is its origin? And why are we haunted by its miserable shadow? Does a mare feel shame as she couples with a stallion? Are they deaf to everything their loins are telling them until we grant them a marriage certificate? I think not. To my mind, shame is nothing but a product of education. Meanwhile, old Father Marin still blindly insists in every single sermon that it's deeply rooted in our sinful human nature. Which is why I now refuse to go to church and—
Happier.
Yes, Mom?
Lord Steeple to see you.
Sorry I'm so late. I threw on a jacket, ran a brush through my hair, and dashed like some phantom to get here.
You slept through the day?
I'm exhausted, Melky. I was up till 3 last night, reading this essay you wrote me, till I couldn't see straight.
Well, sit down, relax.
Look at me. I'm trembling. Last night, I prayed, please, God, give me consumption and take these sticky dreams away from me.
With any luck, you'll ignore that prayer.
Melky, I can't focus on anything. Even now, well, I see and hear and feel quite clearly. Yet everything seems so strange.
But those illustrations I gave you, didn't they help illuminate your dreams?
They only multiplied everything 10 times. Instead of merely seeing stockings, now I'm plagued by labia majora and—
Well, here we are, with tea. Mr. Steeple, how are you?
Very well, thanks, Miss Gabor.
Yes?
Just think, Mom. Moritz was up reading all through the night.
conjugating Greek.
You must take care of yourself, Moritz. Surely your health is more important than ancient Greek. Now, what have you been reading, Melchior?
Goethe's Faust, actually.
Really? At your age?
It's so beautiful, Mom.
So haunting.
Still, I should have thought. But surely you guys don't have an age to decide for yourself what's good for you and what's not. If you need anything else, call me.
Well, your mother certainly is remarkable.
Until she catches her son reading Goethe.
I think she meant the story of Gretchen and her illegitimate child.
Look, you see how everybody so obsessively fixes on that story? It's as if the entire world was mesmerized by penis and vagina.
Well, I am. All the more so, I'm afraid, since reading your essay. What you say about the female, I can't stop thinking about it. This part here, is it true?
Absolutely.
But how can you know that? What the woman must feel?
Giving yourself over to someone else. Defending yourself until finally you surrender and feel heaven break over you. I just put myself in her place. Any match?
What it feels like? For the woman?
Where I go, when I go there, no more memory. Only drifting on some ship, the wind that whispers of the distance to shore. Where I go, when I go there, no more listening anymore. Hands upon your lips, a mystic wisdom rising with them.
Meditator. It truly is daunting. I mean, however we might measure up. Fit. What? I'm not saying I myself ever.
Not that I'm saying. I would ever want to. Whatever wants that. Whatever not wants more. I have to go. Moritz, wait!
Him falling from the branches. What are you doing all alone up here?
Well, Mom's making May wine, so I thought I'd surprise her with some woodruff. And you?
Well, this is my favorite spot. My private place. For thinking.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, no, please. So, how have you been doing?
Well, this morning was wonderful. A huge group of baskets of food and clothing to the day laborers' children.
I remember when we used to do that. Together.
You should have seen their faces, Melchior. It must be brightened their day.
Ilsa?
Oh, it's you.
What are you doing here?
Just bringing my dress to the dry cleaner for Susan Doyle's wedding.
You're wearing that dress?
Yeah.
I think it'll look very pretty on you.
Thank you.
So, do you wanna...
Shall I show it to you?
Yes, I'd love that. It's very delicate.
I'm glad you like it. I don't like it all that much, to be honest.
Well then, why are you wearing it?
Father told me to wear it. He says I always look fine in this.
Actually, it's something I've been thinking about a lot.
The day laborers.
Our little acts of charity. What do you think, Brenda? Does the Sunday school have the right to tell us to be charitable? Don't you think the school and the church try to impose their ideas and desires on us? Don't you think they teach us how to repress what we really think, what we really want?
Yeah, but aren't we ashamed of our prosperity when we see the poor?
Ah, shame. Teachers, the priest, our parents, they all tell us to be ashamed of who we are, of what we feel. Shame is nothing but a product of education. Wendla Bergman, I've known you for so long and we've never truly talked.
That's because we have so few opportunities, now that we're older.
True. In a more progressive world, of course, we could all attend the same school. Boys and girls together. Wouldn't that be remarkable?
My father's the same. He always tells me what to do, what to wear, and nothing's ever good enough.
I think I need to go. It's been really nice talking to you, Moritz. What time is it?
It must be close to 4.
Really? I thought it was much later. I paused and I lay in the moss by the stream and I just let myself dream. So I thought it was much later.
Well then, can't you stay for a moment? When you sit under this oak, you start to think hypnotic things.
Well, I have to be back before 5.
Well, but when you lie here, such a strange and wonderful peace settles over you.
For a moment, maybe. Melchior, I should go.
Well then, let's go together. We'll be on the bridge in 10 minutes.
Let it. Isn't it a nuisance for you?
You may not cut it short, you may not wear it down.
You know what? Tomorrow, I'm bringing scissors.
For God's sakes, Willa, no! Father beats me enough as it is.
Really? No, it's nothing.
Ilsa?
Ilsa, we're your friends.
Well, when I don't do as he likes, some nights, Papa yanks out his belt.
Where's your mama?
We've got rules in this house. Your father will not be disobeyed. The other night, I ran out for the door. Out the door? All right, I like that. That's where you'll spend your night, out on the street. It was so cold.
No.
He beats you with a belt. With anything. With a buckle.
Oh God!
Ilsa, the belts, they're terrible.
We must tell someone.
No, Anna.
But we must.
No, no, they'll throw me out for good. I wonder what I would do if my father beat me. If I wouldn't just run away.
What? Those girls who run away and live their lives on the street?
I couldn't.
She's right. We've all heard the horror stories. What happens to those girls on the streets one cannot imagine.
Honestly, what would we do without the adults guiding us?
My dad says if you don't discipline a child, you don't love it.
That must be.
Well, when I have children, I'll let them be free. And they'll grow strong and tall.
Free? But how will we know what to do if our parents won't tell us?
Ilsa, time for bed now.
There's a part I can't tell about the dark I know well.
Ilsa, put on a new nightgown. Pretty ruffled on your father bought you.
You said time for bed now, child. Just like she knows.
November 27th. The trouble is, the terrible prerogative of the parentocracy in secondary education.
Mr. Stafer, may I have a word with you?
A world where teachers like parents view us as merely so much raw material for an obedient and productive society. A unified, military-like body, where everything that is weak must be hammered away. Where the progress of the students reflects back only on the rank and order of the faculty, and therefore You.
I was lying by the stream, and then I saw you.
Yes.
So.
The stream. You're dreaming again.
I was, I guess.
So what were you dreaming of?
It's silly.
Please tell me.
I dreamt I was a clumsy little girl who spilled her father's coffee, and when he saw what I'd done, he yanked out his belt and beat me.
Well, no, that kind of thing doesn't happen anymore. Only in the stories.
Ilse gets beaten almost every evening. The next day, you can see the welts. It's terrible. Lately, it's all I can think about.
Well, someone should file a complaint.
You know, I've never been beaten. Not once. I can't even imagine it. It must be just awful.
I don't believe anybody's ever better for it.
I tried hitting myself to see how it really feels inside. With this twig, for example, it's tough and thin.
It would draw blood.
You mean if you beat me with it?
Beat you?
Me?
Now what are you thinking?
Nothing.
I could never beat you.
But if I let you?
Never!
But if I asked you to...
But have you lost your mind?
Ilse, she told me
that... You can't envy someone else being beaten.
But I've never been beaten. My entire life I've never felt...
What?
Anything. Please, Melky. I don't feel it.
Well... Maybe not with your dress on.
On my legs, then.
Wendell.
Come on, please!
I'll teach you to say please.
You're barely stroking me.
How's that, then?
Ilse's father, he used the belt, he draws blood, Melky!
How's that?
Nothing!
And that?
Nothing!
I mean, how long have you...
Father?
Mortz. Yes.
Well, I was wondering, hypothetically speaking, what would happen if...
If?
If one day I failed.
Nothing. Tell me you failed.
No.
You failed, haven't you? I can see it on your face.
Father, no.
Well, it's finally come to this. I can't say I'm surprised. Now tell me, son, what are your mother and I supposed to do, huh? How can she show her face at the Missionary Society? What do I tell them at the bank? How do we go to church? Failed! My son, failed! Thank God my father never lived to see this day.
I I want to just...
What? What's wrong again?
I can't take it anymore. My dad, he doesn't get anything. My head is about to explode. How am I supposed to appease all these high demands? My parents, grades. I can barely even memorize a line of Latin, let alone the entire Aeneid. I will fail. I am a failure.
Please, just... What? I'm done listening to your self-pity. Look, I just can't deal with this right now, okay? Grow up. We all have our own issues.
Well, if that's how you feel, I just wanted to let you know, this is the last you will see of me.
What the hell do you mean?
Nothing. I will go deal with my own problems.
What? Tell me!
I'm leaving. I'm leaving with Ilse. We're running away.
What? You can't run away. Not with her, not with Ilse. How do you even know she wants to run away with you? She will. Do you know the girl you love? Ilse can't, she could never run away with you. This is something bigger than you, trust me. Ilse has issues at home. She could never run away from them. She's being abused by a father!
What? No, then we definitely have to leave. We have to and we will. I have to.
Just let me be. This is a ridiculous plan. You're being foolish.
You don't get it. Your life is perfect. You're the smartest guy in school. Me? This is my only chance. Just fuck it. I can't do this anymore.
So here you are.
Go away. Please.
There's a storm coming, you know? You can't just sit sulking in some hayloft.
Out!
Everybody's at church. They're rehearsing for the Michaelmas chorale, but I slipped out.
Yes? Well?
Your friend Mort Stiefel was absent. Someone said he's been missing all day.
Well, I expect his head is full of Michaelmas.
Perhaps. You know I have your journal.
You do?
You left it the other day. I confess I tried reading parts of it, but...
Just leave it, please.
Melchior. I'm sorry about what happened. Truly, I am. I completely understand why you'd be angry with me. I don't know what
don't,
I was...
Don't, please, no. Just don't.
But how can I not?
We were confused. We were both just
No,
confused.
It was my fault!
Just leave it! It was me. All me. Something in me started when I hate you.
Well, something in me too.
But I hurt you.
Yes, but still.
No more, just... Just go away.
Won't you come out to the meadow now, Melchior? Dark in here and stuffy. We could run through the rain, get soaked to the skin, and not even care.
Look at me.
It was me. All me.
I hear your heartbeat, my love.
I don't know.
No matter where I am, I hear it beating.
And I hear yours. Melchior. No, wait, no.
Wendla.
No, stop. I can't. We're not supposed to.
Not supposed to what? Love? I don't know. Is there such a thing? I hear your heart. I feel you breathe.
wears is merely quaint, as dubious, as old. And yet, let us pose this question, each of us within our own dark heart. In what ways have we honored and dishonored our father and mother? In what ways have we strayed in soul and in body from all the wise instruction of our clergy, our teachers?
Don't do sadness, just don't care. Stiefel?
Oh, you came.
Why did you urge me to come here at night time? Your father would be mad.
You care about what your father thinks? You deserve better, Ilse. Look, I have a proposition.
Proposition?
Yes. You and I, we can, you know.
What words?
We can leave.
Leave?
You and I, we can start over. We can go to America. No parents, no grades, just us. Imagine. See the entire horizon. Now, only the dusk, the first few stars. So dark, so dark, so dark.
I must take immediate and decisive steps. Unless the
school be perceived as one of those institutions afflicted by the veritable epidemic of adolescent suicide.
This will not be an easy war to win. There is not only the moral corruption of the youth, but also the creeping sensuality of these liberal-minded times.
This is war! Naturally, there must be casualty. Mr. Gabor! Come in. It would seem, young man, that all roads end in you. You don't know what I mean?
I'm afraid. As well one would be. 2 days after his father learned of the young
Moritz
Stiefel's death, we searched through the boy's effects and uncovered a certain depraved and atheistic document. A document which makes terribly clear the moral corruption of the young man. A corruption which no doubt hastened the boy's end. I am referring, as you may know, to a 10-page essay entitled, coyly enough, The Art of Sleeping With, accompanied by, shall we say, lifelike illustrations.
Mr. Figgins, if I could only—
Behave properly. Yes, that would be another affair entirely. I have made a thorough examination of the handwriting of this obscene document. And I have compared it to that of every single pupil.
Miss Rowan, if you could—
You must now answer only the precisely stated questions with a swift and decisive, yeah, all a no. Mr. Gabor. Did you write this? Did you write this?
There's a moment, you know, you're fucked. Not an inch more room to self-destruct. No more moves, oh yeah, the dead end zone.
everything we touch is turned to dirt. In the end, we have only each other. We must build a different world. Despite what those whispering elders may say, I must set my head against your breast. We must breathe again and move together in that paradise.
Child, don't fret. I've been prescribing these since before you were born. So, 3 times a day, an hour before meals, and in a few weeks you should be fine breakfasting and suckling pig.
So that's all it is, Doctor. Anemia.
C'est tout.
And the nausea?
Not uncommon. Trust me, child, you'll be fine. Miss Bergman, if I could have a word with you.
Certainly, Doctor. Mama? Wendla, what have you done to yourself? To me?
I don't know.
You don't know?
The doctor just said that I'm anemic.
Well, probably. You're going to have a child.
A child, but I'm not married.
Precisely. Wendla, what have you done?
I don't know. Truly, I don't.
Well, I think you know. And now, I need his name.
His name, but I don't even know what you're talking about. That. Mama, I just wanted to be with him, to hold him and be close to him.
Wendla, no more. You'll break my heart.
My God, why didn't you tell me everything?
You are going to have to tell me who. Wendla, I'm waiting. Oliver. Wendla. Melchior Gabor. Wendla!
Mama, who bore me? Mama, who
my darling, I follow your lead. We have given the boy room, but now he must eat of the bitter fruit. He has shown himself utterly corrupt.
He has not.
Hear me out.
But I have. Melchior wrote an essay.
every word of which was true. Are we so afraid of the truth? We will join the ranks of cowards and fools, twisting his naive act into evidence against him. I will not have Melchior sent to some reformatory.
And now, I must break your heart. This afternoon, Miss Bergman came to see me, bearing a letter that Melchior wrote to young Wendla, in which he describes that he has no regrets for what transpired in our Haylock.
Impossible.
That he only wishes again to find that piece of paradise.
Let me see that.
Yes, do have a look. See, the wretched fact is, Melchior knew precisely what he was doing. And as an essay shows, he knew the risk of doing it. And yet he went ahead, defiling himself and all but destroying that poor girl. So tell me, what shall we do?
What you will. A reformatory.
My dear Melchior, I only pray this letter reaches you. I've written so many and I've heard nothing back. When I think of your life in that terrible place, my heart aches. If only I could be close to you, talk to you. I have such remarkable news. Something has happened, Melchior. Something I can barely understand myself.
All right, boys. Each one of us puts in a coin. Come on, cuff it up. What you looking at? Nothing. Once part of the sport. Oh, he's too busy fucking a slut.
You shit!
Oops. Does it hurt? Well, let's check your pockets for money, eh, shall we?
Bastard!
Oh. What's this? A letter from your bitch? My dear Melchior, I only pray this letter reaches you. I've written so many and have heard enough.
Son of a bitch!
Listen up, folks. Best thing for recent works.
Miss Bergman.
Thank you for meeting me. Your name was given me by a doctor.
I understand.
So many dreams of the better world that we will build together with our child.
Child?
He doesn't know. Put a pup in his bitch and doesn't even. Get it!
But where are we going, Mama?
Miss Bergman. Good, I'll take her now.
Mama, I'll be there with you. Every moment.
No, Mama, don't leave me! Mama!
Ellie. I've been running for days, but at last I am back. Now, I beg you, for the sake of our old friendship, bring Wendla to meet me tonight in the graveyard behind the church.
Oh, no.
I will be waiting there at midnight, Melchior Gabor.
So he hasn't heard?
Waiting for Wendla?
Or Melchior?
Poor Wendla.
Wendla? Wendla?
Look at this. Spend your whole life running from the church, and where do you wind up? Moritz, my old friend. But they won't get me. Or Wendell. I won't let them. We'll build that world together. For our child. Midnight. Wendell! My God. All these little tombs. Here. Fresh one. Here rests in God Wendell. Died? Of anemia? No. No!
Behind you,
Moritz,
all alone. They linger till they find you,
Moritz. I've been a fool.
Without them, world grows dark around you, and nothing is the same until you know that they have found you.
We have the right idea. Let's get a little earth.
The stars, the moon alone, they're burning. The stars too, they tell of spring.